हेलो स्टूडेंट्स, वेलकम टू दिस लेक्चर ऑन यूनिट 3 वेयर वी विल बी डिस्कसिंग अबाउट एग्रीकल्चर इन इंडिया। आई एम डॉक्टर दीपाली भिड़े, वर्किंग एज असिस्टेंट प्रोफेसर इन द डिपार्टमेंट ऑफ ज्योग्राफी, डीजी रूपारेल कॉलेज, मुंबई। इन दिस टॉपिक वी विल बी डिस्कसिंग अबाउट द कैरेक्टरिस्टिक्स ऑफ इंडियन एग्रीकल्चर। वी विल ऑल्सो डिस्कस अबाउट the green revolution in India, then what are the problems associated with Indian agriculture, and we will critically analyze the national agricultural policies. At the end of this topic, we will understand about the characteristics of Indian agriculture, we will learn about green revolution in India, we will be able to analyze the problems associated with Indian agriculture, and will also study the national agricultural policies. So when we look at the Indian economy, we know that it is an agro-based economy. Even today, with more than 50% of the population being dependent on agriculture, and therefore when we look at the features of Indian agriculture, no doubt there is pressure of population. More than 50% of Indian population is dependent on agriculture directly or indirectly, and therefore there is pressure on cultivable land. The per capita land holdings are small as we have more population dependent on land, which has an impact on agricultural productivity, which is low. And of course, with growing technology, growing industrialization, there is also competition from non-agricultural activities. Secondly, Indian agriculture is labor intensive. Again, going back to the same fact that there is more population, you also have the issue of fragmentation of land, which we have discussed in the earlier topic. Similarly, farmers, many of them being very poor, they continue to make use of traditional farm equipments, and only the rich farmers, especially in the states of Punjab, Haryana, Gujarat, Maharashtra, where they have started making use of modern machinery, but the number is still less. Mostly we find that agriculture in India is subsistence. We know that subsistence means that the farm produce is meant for home consumption, or at the most it will enter the local market. And combination of crops cultivated includes millets, maize and pulses grown in the kharif season. Wheat and gram, these are grown in the rabi season. And again, in North India, along the Indo-Gangetic belt, we come across some kind of market-oriented agriculture. But otherwise, overall in the country, subsistence farming is practiced. Then there is dominance of food grains. More than two-thirds of the total cropped area is utilized for cultivation of food crops like rice, maize, pulses, millets, etc. We come across highest proportion of area under cultivation, where 55% of the total geographical area is under cultivation, which is the highest compared to Canada, Japan, USA, etc. Similarly, Indian farming is dependent on rain. There is heavy dependence on monsoon. We know that monsoon is uncertain, it is irregular, it is erratic. We do not know when it will start, what will be the duration of the rainfall, what will be the volume of rainfall. And overall, the distribution of monsoon in the country is uneven. So it also puts pressure on agriculture. Overall, the productivity of agriculture is low because there is less use of fertilizers, there is absence of following scientific cropping mechanism, and many other obstacles which makes it difficult for the farmers to increase the productivity. Plus, we cannot forget that there is heavy pressure of population on the land. Now, farmers in India, about 85% of cultivators are under debt. That is, they have taken a loan, and it is very common among subsistence cultivators from states like Maharashtra, Tamil Nadu, Punjab, Haryana, etc. And mostly these poor and small farmers, they depend on local money lenders, which can result into a lot of exploitation of the farmers. Moving on to the Green Revolution in India. It was one of the success stories, and it occurred because of the efforts of Dr. Norman Borlaug, who was an American biologist and also known as the father of Green Revolution. Now, what is Green Revolution? It is nothing but successful agricultural experiment which was done in many developing countries, including in India, and it was introduced in 1960s. The focus was on use of some of the modern techniques in agriculture, which helped the country to shift from a food importing country to a food exporting country, because there was a significant rise in the agricultural production. And that was something that which was needed in those times. Another name which we cannot forget is Professor M.S. Swaminathan, who was the advisor of the agriculture minister then. He was the person who invited Dr. Borlaug to India. Now, what are these components of Green Revolution? So the focus is on use of high yielding variety seeds, or HYV seeds. Now, these seeds require a large amount of water, so obviously better irrigation facilities are required. To increase the production, use of chemical fertilizers is done, and to protect the crop, protect the produce, use of insecticides and pesticides is done. Similarly, land reforms were required, because we have discussed this earlier that the land in India is controlled by the process of fragmentation and the land tenure system. So the land areas become small in size because of fragmentation, and therefore these land reforms were necessary, where the consolidation of land was done. Similarly, command area development program was introduced. So supply of agricultural credit was done, with nationalization of banks, development of rural banks, rural electrification was necessary. There was a need to develop better roads in the rural areas, which will help in transportation and marketing of farm produce. Similarly, the inputs which the farmers require, machinery, seeds, fertilizers, they could be taken to the farmers, and farm mechanization. All these were changes necessary to bring in a revolution in agricultural production. Simultaneously, there was development of agricultural universities, which will provide the facility of soil testing, which will help the farmers to know better about their land, better about what is the need of water to the crops, etc. Development of guaranteed minimum prices, multiple cropping programs. Now, all these were changes which were necessary for making Green Revolution successful. So what was the impact of Green Revolution? So positive impact was that, first of all, it helped in increasing the agricultural production to a great extent, and it also focused on reduction in import, because earlier our country had to import a lot of food grains from other countries, which automatically put pressure on the budget of the country. So that was something which was remarkable as the agricultural production increased. Similarly, use of advanced agricultural infrastructure, that was something which was brought in by Green Revolution. So dams were constructed, various other facilities of irrigation were provided by the government. So farmers could make use of some better techniques, better equipments because of Green Revolution. Similarly, it also helped in the lowering the problem of food crisis. So problems of hunger were lowered. With lowering of prices for food, it helped people to consume better and healthier food, and nutrition of the people was much more improved. It also helped in increasing employment opportunities, because as agriculture was strengthened, many agro-based industries also were started. So it helped in forward and backward linkages between agriculture and the industry. So simultaneously, as agriculture started prospering, it also helped in the development of some small-scale industries, agro-based industries, and which helped in developing industrial linkages. There was a change in attitude of the farmers with adoption of new strategy of Green Revolution. It definitely shifted from subsistence farming to commercial farming. So attitude of the farmers also underwent a change because of Green Revolution. And of course, industrial growth, because now there was a demand for many machines required in agriculture, like tractors, harvesters, threshers, electric motors, diesel engines, water pumps, etc., chemical fertilizers, pesticides, insecticides, etc. So simultaneously, these industries also started growing. And as I mentioned earlier, agro-based industries also, like textile, sugar industry, and so on, these industries also started developing. So the positive impact of Green Revolution was definitely seen in the country. Now, as their impact was positive, there were some side effects which also cannot be ignored. So what did Green Revolution bring in? Now, as it brought in prosperity, it also brought in some intercrop imbalances. So for example, all food grains like wheat, rice, jowar, bajra, maize, these food grains they gained from Green Revolution, but maximum benefit was posed by wheat, and it captured almost various areas from other coarse cereal crops, pulses, oilseeds, and because of which there was an intercrop imbalance. Similarly, it also gave rise to regional disparity, which affected only 40% of the total cropped area and 60% is still untouched. So it showed effects in those areas which were already in a better off condition in agricultural production. And in those areas where agriculture was not prospering, Green Revolution did not bring in success in these areas. It also gave rise to unemployment, because new agricultural strategy introduced the use of machinery in agriculture, and when machinery is used, obviously labor is not required. So increased mechanization created problems of labor displacement and unemployment. It increased the gap between rich farmers and poor farmers. So as it resulted into regional disparity, those farmers which were already rich otherwise, even before the use of Green Revolution, after Green Revolution was introduced, these farmers, they became more rich, and it did not bring in much success to small and marginal farmers, because they are the ones who were not in a position to buy these inputs which are required for a very successful Green Revolution technology. So Green Revolution definitely has put in trouble for these areas or these issues. Now, what are the problems associated with Indian agriculture? So some of them we have discussed even earlier, like there is heavy dependence on monsoon, and irrigation facilities, even if they are available, they are not widely available. They are available in some areas. In many areas, having water for agriculture is still a problem. We also come across the cropping pattern. So the crops grown in India are divided into food crops and non-food crops. So food crops consist of food grains, whereas non-food crops consist of fibers, oil seeds, etc. So there is a fall in agricultural activity production primarily due to decrease in the output of non-food articles. Land ownership in India also is a major issue, because we know that the system of land ownership is affected by fragmentation of land. So there is a lot of inequality in land distribution, and a large area of land in India is owned by a relatively small section of rich farmers, landlords, money lenders, and majority of the farmers own very little amount of land or no land at all. And because of these uneconomic small land holdings, introducing better methods of cultivation or machinery or more advanced techniques becomes a difficulty. There is lack of advanced agricultural inputs like seeds, fertilizers, pesticides, machinery, etc. So use of better irrigation, more better machinery, advanced pesticides, these are a difficulty because of, again, issues like small land holdings, farmers' economic situation is not very well to do, where they can afford and invest heavily in these inputs. So these are also difficulties which many Indian farmers they face. Then the lack of storage facilities also is a major problem, because we know that after the harvesting is done, the crop has to be, the yield has to be stored. And because storage facilities are lacking in many rural areas, it puts a lot of pressure on the farmer. Transport facilities also are not very well developed, or they are not affordable to the farmers, efficient. They are not efficient in terms of speed. And even at present, there are lakhs of villages which are not well connected with the main roads or with the market centers. Scarcity of capital, that is another obstacle, because as mentioned earlier, that all these advanced farm technologies, they are very costly. And many farmers who are poor or marginal, they cannot afford to invest in these techniques because of lack of capital. Marketing facilities also pose a lot of problem, many times the farmers are not aware of the market conditions. What are the price of the crops? How to get maximum benefit or profit? Knowledge, exact knowledge about the market conditions. These are also obstacles that the farmers face, and it really becomes a difficulty. And therefore, adequate attention has to be given on these issues. Now, coming to the National Agriculture Policy of India, which was announced on 28 July 2000 to promote agricultural productivity or national food security and economic growth and development through value chain development. So the objectives of the policy are a growth rate in excess of 4% per annum in the agriculture sector, growth that is based on efficient use of resources and conserves soil, water and biodiversity, growth with equality, which is widespread across regions and farmers, growth that is demand driven and caters to domestic markets and maximizes benefits from exports of agricultural products to meet the challenges arising from economic liberalization and globalization, growth that is sustainable technologically, environmentally and economically. So the main features of National Agricultural Policy are privatization of agriculture and price protection to the farmers, participation of private sector through contract farming and land leasing arrangements, development of national livestock breeding strategy to meet the requirement of milk, meat, egg, livestock products, priority to develop new location, specific and economically viable improved varieties of farm and horticulture crops, livestock species and aquaculture, removal of restrictions on the movement of agricultural commodities throughout the country, and a review in the structure of taxes on food grains and other commercial crops. Similarly, review of excise duty on materials such as farm machinery and implements, fertilizers and other inputs which are required in agricultural production, that would also be done by this policy. More significance will be given to rural electrification. There will be encouragement to make use of new as well as renewable sources of energy for irrigation, and other agricultural purposes will be given. Progressive institutionalization of rural and farm credit would be continued for providing timely and adequate credit to farmers. So farmers, those who do not have access to capital, they can also invest money in their farms and increase the production and profit. New venture must be made to provide a package and insurance policy for the farmers. So overall, this policy appears to be very positive and in the benefit of the farmers. However, there are certain points of criticism. So some of these weaknesses are identified by these people. So according to Tham Rajakshi, in the year 2000, the themes of the policy are too general and unrelated to the specified objectives. Probably there is no clear-cut focus on or direct focus on certain problems. Whereas Deshpande and Prashita in 2006 have pointed out that the National Agriculture Policy has not followed some simple steps in evolving a national level policy frame. They have also opined that the policy ignored the importance of evolving a policy with involvement of all the stakeholders. It also missed the important steps of review of earlier experience, inviting comments, deliberations on various dimensions of the policy, etc. So, in this topic, we have discussed about the characteristics of Indian agriculture, what we come across, what is the current status of Indian agriculture in terms of land reforms, in terms of farm machinery in terms of more advanced technology. Similarly, what has been the success story of Green Revolution in India? What are the positive outcomes of Green Revolution? What are the side effects? What are the negative impacts of Green Revolution? And we also did discuss and had a critical overview of the National Agricultural Policy of India. For further reading and questions, please refer to the study material provided by IDOL, University of Mumbai. And you can check in the questions given at the end of the topic for self-learning so that you get a better understanding of this topic. Thank you.